This was one of those cases that shocked our newsroom and the entire state of New Hampshire.
It would take dramatic turns.
All that power, all that money.
The investigation was like a tidal wave hitting Epping.
This becomes a very dark chapter in this small town's history.
Evidence is rapidly disappearing.
Okay, I'm re-recording this message. I'm not sure which one you're getting.
Put a lot of fear in people.
That was always a concern, that there were potentially other victims.
Whatever happened needs to be found out.
I feel that he may kill me, try to kill me. This has to be stopped.
Epping, New Hampshire is a small town. It is located over by the seacoast.
There's a main street, old Victorians downtown, a small local theater.
It's known for having a good community feel.
We never would have expected that we would be responding to a sleepy farm in Epping for the kinds of things that had happened there.
Sheila LaBarre was, in many ways, a Southern Belle, or she wanted to be a Southern Belle.
I definitely owe you some baby back pork ribs.
Sheila is coming out of a few unhappy relationships in the late 80s and seeking a fresh start.
In many ways, this story starts with a search for love for several different people, including Dr. LaBarre.
Dr. Bill LaBarre had previously served in the military and has settled down into Epping, New Hampshire as a chiropractor.
He was lonely. He wanted to meet somebody, and he was able to meet through a singles ad, Sheila LaBarre.
Dr. LaBarre passed away fairly quickly and unexpectedly.
Now, they never get married at any point, but she assumes ownership of this farm.
After Dr. LaBarre passes away, Sheila starts dating.
Has good sense of humor, likes sports.
Caller block. Someone new is responding to you.
Kenneth County is a guy that grew up in Massachusetts. He liked playing sports as a kid. As he gets older, he comes back from the Army and winds up getting a job and moving in with a friend.
Kenny was really starting to spread his wings and really wanted to be his own person and have his own productive life as an adult.
He is looking for love. Sheila LaBarre is looking for love.
Fun. Okay, here's what I like to do for fun.
They talk on the phone. Hey, let's meet up.
I met him at the Ashworth on Valentine's evening.
And they meet up out in Hampton, New Hampshire, which is a seacoast town.
And so they meet there for their first date, which apparently goes very well because Kent County goes back to Epping with Sheila and ends up staying there. The more we learn about Sheila's past, we see the very dark periods in her life.
I tried to kill myself. I took a full bottle of sleeping pills. The last memory I have was before the car wreck.
After the crash, she was in a coma, and they did not know if she would come out of the coma, and if so, what she would be like. When Sheila came out of her coma, she related that she had a vision, that her life had purpose, that she met God. Conversations with her sister, Lynn, actually confirm sexual abuse in her life, starting with her father.
He had his hand around her, and his hand was up her little dress.
And her father's friends, which he would invite to take part in abuse of Sheila.
Kenneth has a very close relationship with his mother. She's constantly in communication with him through his phone, and she likes to hear where he is. She wants to hear how he's doing.
Kent County had special needs. He was a little bit slow in learning.
His mother would describe him as being mentally deficient.
When Carolyn, Ken County's mother, doesn't hear from Kenny for some time, she reaches out to his roommate. The roommate doesn't put her at ease. He actually exacerbates her concerns. He indicates that Kenny's van, which he was very proud of, was still at the apartment, and that his job was also looking for him because they hadn't heard from him and didn't know where he was.
Naturally, his mother starts to worry about him.
She starts reaching out to the police, requesting that they go check on her son. They go out to the farm.
Picture, if you will, a dead-end dirt road with a few sort of houses and farm buildings on it. And at the very dead end of that road is where you find the LaBarre household.
Kenneth speaks to them through an upstairs window. So they've confirmed that he's alive, but the circumstances are incredibly odd.
The local Walmart finds a woman inside who's acting erratically. Turns out it was Sheila LaBarre. Police arrive at the Walmart there. They go into the store to check out what's going on, and they find Kenneth County sitting in a wheelchair. Kenneth County has bruises all over him. He's got dark rings under his eyes. His skin is ashen.
Ken is gaunt. His appearance has dramatically changed.
Police are worried about it. They follow them out to their truck outside of this Walmart and can see Kenneth County getting into this truck, not saying much, as the two of them drive away, not knowing what really happened to him.
He is right beside me on the bed, bleeding from a self-inflicted wound. He has scalded himself. He'll blame me for his injuries, but he infected the blind.
Just a minute. What else? Give me his phone number. I'm not fighting this man over their mother.
I know, you're right.
Carolyn reaches somewhat of a breaking point when she gets a call from Sheila LaBarre, who tells Carolyn that Kenny is no longer living with her.
She's asking people in town to help her out. Do they know where he is?
Carolyn reaches out again to the police.
So it's a typical day in the newsroom, and we get a report of a missing person in Epping. People in town are nervous. They don't know what happened to this guy that was living up on this farm. Was there foul play? Did he disappear on his own? Is he okay somewhere?
The police go out in the evening, and one of the first things they note is a burn pile not far from the front door, and it's actively smoldering, burning.
So at this point, it's late March. We have a missing person. Police have gone to this LaBarre farm and start to comb through every detail, every spot of that farm that they can.
One of the first things they note is a burn pile not far from the front door. Not only do they see what they believe is human flesh, but also some bones or bone fragments. Seeing the burn pile is foreshadowed by a Walmart in the wheelchair. Sheila was piling gasoline containers on his lap.
I said, and you let her take him. You didn't take my son at Walmart. You just let her take him. She's going to kill him.
While the search warrant is being executed at Sheila's house, she willingly comes in and does a long, long interview with two highly experienced police officers. I'm able to watch, and as I'm watching Sheila, it is clear She is enjoying this. It is a cat and mouse game, and she wasn't giving up anything. And she enjoyed the attention. We don't have enough legally to go forward, and so we have to release her. We decide that police need to tail her and follow her while we continue to work on gathering enough to get an arrest warrant. The police are following her first thing in the morning and reporting back to myself and their unit commanders. And within a half hour of the first report, they lost her. She vanished, she disappeared.
Her picture is pasted on TVs throughout New England at this point as the manhunt continues for this now suspected murderer.
I would caution the public to approaching her and to call the police immediately if in fact she's contacted.
We thoroughly believe we have identified the woman that's responsible for Ken County's death. And now she's lost in the ether.
Now again, Sheila LaBarre is not in custody and police are actively searching for her.
LaBarre was last seen in Manchester on Tuesday, sometime on Tuesday. She has not been seen in the area since.
And while police won't be searching her farm this weekend, they'll be back first thing Monday morning.
When we sprayed a chemical reagent that reacts to human blood, the toilet bowl, all around the sides of the toilet bowl reacted. So we decide to pump the septic system. And when we do so, we find a birth certificate belonging to someone named Mike Deloge. It raises serious alarm bells. This is the kind of document that you don't flush down a toilet unless you're trying to erase somebody's existence.
So this, of course, puts the community even more on edge because now we start to get the sense that were there other murders that happened on that farm?
Michael Deloge grew up in the blue-collar town of West Haven, Connecticut, and lived in this house with his father and stepmother. Deloge dreamed of being a songwriter.
He was really funny. I mean, he had a lot of energy.
But Deloge's family says he had a history of trouble with drugs and alcohol and few job skills. It's unclear how he wound up at a Portsmouth homeless shelter, but that's where he reportedly met Sheila LaBarre.
We start to see a pattern, if you will.
He really didn't have any discretionary ideas when it came to men. It was really about hooking them. Most of them were either much older or they were not financially secure.
She'll offer to take them to the farm, pay them for their work, and in some cases, they would become lovers.
This is an interview with Michael Todd Deloge, who makes his living off women, off innocent, kind-hearted people.
Mike Deloge and Sheila dated for some time.
One night in the summer of 2004, his stepmother says she received a call in the middle of the night.
Do you really want to be responsible for the death of a loved one? Turn your back on Michael Deloge before it's too late.
And it was this crazy woman talking about, she was quoting scriptures from the Bible.
May God watch over all of you.
I remember her saying that he was a child molester. How could I let him do that?
He is a very dangerous person, a passive-aggressive, cruel killer. Most pedophiles, before they kill, begin doing the same things that Michael Deloge has done.
LaBarre accused the Deloges of letting Michael assault his younger siblings, a claim his stepsister denies.
She said, you know, how could my mother let this happen, that supposedly he had molested us when we were younger? And it's just so untrue.
Sheila LaBarre also made similar accusations about Kenneth County being a pedophile, which he wasn't.
Ted Michael County, age 24, has told me that he himself is turned on by this 6-year-old boy.
And you can hear her yelling, saying, you're faking right now. So you can actually hear the abuse that she captured on this audio tape.
Mike Deloge is listed as a missing person. There is an investigation ongoing into the fact that he has been missing.
The more information that police release about what they found went on there at the farm, the more people started to turn on Sheila LaBarre and who she was.
The rest for doing that, just for doing that. I will be there in a minute. You better hope I don't see you.
We have two missing individuals. We have a visit to Walmart with gas tanks.
People are on edge. They don't know where she is. We don't know where she is. And she could be in your neighborhood. She could be in your town.
We have the swirling accusations about her. And now, on top of that, we're finding body parts.
There were toes that were found at that farm that didn't belong to Kenneth County or to Michael Deloge. Police didn't know where Sheila LaBarre had fled to at this point. So all you're hearing on TV and in newspapers is this description of this woman now wanted for murder.
The next big break was somewhat serendipitous, where this man showed up to talk to police about a woman he thinks we may be looking for.
She got in the car and she was telling me that she had a fight with her boyfriend. Her car had broken down in Manchester, and she had to get to Boston.
And he goes on to tell us about his day spent with Sheila.
I mean, she seemed so nice, you know?
So at least we know what direction she's heading in.
In the newsroom, we get word that Sheila LaBarre has been arrested just over the border in Massachusetts. There is now this huge sense of relief that she has been caught and will now be brought back to New Hampshire to face charges.
LaBarre stands accused of dismembering and burning the body of 24-year-old Kenneth County, a special needs adult she took on as a live-in lover. Another man who once lived at LaBarre's farm, Michael Deloge, is also missing.
The identification of Ken County was solidified when we finally were able to get a 100% match through forensic radiology.
Arriving for her jury selection, this is Sheila LaBarre early Monday. She's allowed in the courthouse, but not in the courtroom. It's the only glimpse of LaBarre we'd get.
Well, LaBarre was only charged with Kenneth County's murder on her farm just a short distance from here, but she doesn't deny that there's proof that she also killed Deloge a year earlier, and now the death of both men are part of her trial.
We're making small talk with the defense counsel who's seated across the table, and offhandedly, he tells us that they're going to be pursuing an insanity defense.
In other words, you are agreeing that you committed the acts of murder, but you are saying you are not legally responsible for your actions because of your mental condition at the time. Is that right?
That is correct.
At issue, was she insane at the time she admittedly killed two of her boyfriends? Her defense says yes, but the state says she knew exactly what she was doing.
An insanity defense was literally the rug being yanked out from under us.
I think a lot of people are upset that Sheila LaBarre might get off easy here with the insanity defense.
If she is found insane, we're told that she would head to the psych ward at the state prison, that is, for 5 years at a time, at which time she'd be reevaluated every 5 years.
The defense played up that surely somebody that did all of these things must be insane.
You know, you're crazy.
Coffee, hot coffee with extra cream and extra sugar. Hot coffee.
We have concerns at that point. Everything we've gathered, whether it now is relevant or irrelevant when we're analyzing insanity.
The announcement came that the verdict was in. The families of LaBarre's two victims filed into the courtroom quietly, obviously nervous, because they weren't really sure how this was going to go. As the hours have started to tick by in the last 2 days, they became more and more anxious as to what the decision would actually be.
How say you? Is the defendant sane and guilty, or is the defendant not guilty by reason of insanity?
I hereby sentence you to 2 life in prison without the possibility of parole sentences at the New Hampshire State Prison, and you are remanded in the custody of the sheriff.
So when the verdict was finally announced, they could not hold their emotion back anymore.
The mother of LeVar's second victim, Kenneth County, weeps as she hugs prosecutor Jane Young. Young herself can't hold back the tears. In fact, all 3 of the prosecuting attorneys cry as they hug the family. But Kenneth County's mother and father were perhaps the most emotional. Divorced and both remarried, they reunited for an embrace as this trial brought both of their families together.
At the core of this case are these 2 victims, Kenneth County and Michael DeLoge. There are families that have been involved in this that lost 2 loved ones.
I am very happy she got the 2 life sentences in prison. She can't get out. She can't go hurt nobody else.
Now these 2 families have to pick up the pieces in the national spotlight, I might add, and move on with their lives somehow.
Having Sheila locked up, having her off the streets, especially around vulnerable people, makes the community so much safer, especially when she could isolate people that wouldn't pop up on the radar.
The family of Kenneth County telling me that this memorial site is so important to them.
And each time I come here, I add a little bit more to the memorial site. This is my son, who I cherish and love deeply.
The LeBar family was able to recoup some of the rights to their father's property, to this family property, and Sheila LeBar had kind of with an iron fist taken control of all this and taken control of that money. So the story was now in the books behind them, and the town could move on from this really dark chapter in their history.
The community of Epping is always going to have some echo, shadow of the Sheila LeBar case surrounding it. As the community grows and develops, that diminishes, but it's always there.